God's Word and are following along with me. Galatians chapter 4, verses 8 through 18. If you got your place, say amen.
Amen.
Alright. You don't say over me.
Alright.
Galatians chapter 4, beginning verse 8 says, "Howbeit then, when you knew not God, you did service unto them which by nature are no gods. But now, after that you have known God, or rather are known God, how turn ye again to the weak and beggarly elements, whereunto you desire again to be in bondage? You observe days and months and times and years. I'm afraid of you, lest I have bestowed upon you labor in vain. Brethren, I beseech you, be as I am, for I am as you are. You have not injured me at all. You know how through infirmity of flesh I preached the gospel unto you at the first. And my temptation which was in my flesh you despised not, nor rejected, but received me as an angel of God, even as Christ Jesus. Wherein is then the blessedness you spake of? For I bear you record that if it had been possible, you would have plucked out your own eyes and have given them to me. Am I therefore become your enemy? Because I tell you the truth. They zealously affect you, but not well. Yea, they would exclude you that you might affect them. But it is good to be zealously affected always in a good thing, and not only when I am present with you." Let's go, Lord, in prayer. Heavenly Father, Almighty God, we love you, and we just thank you for another opportunity to be in your house. And Lord, today, as we open your word, God, we are desiring to hear from you. And Lord, we cannot do this alone, God. We desire your presence in this place, and Lord, that it might fall. And Father, I just pray that, Lord, you'd awaken our spirits this morning, Lord, whatever it is that has stood in our way, Father, this morning, whatever it is that has got us downtrodden, God, this morning, Lord, that would just fall away in comparison, God, to what you're saying to us right now in your Holy Scriptures. And God, may you do a work in our lives that might change us for all eternity. And Lord God, if there's someone lost in this place, Lord, don't let them leave that way. Father, I pray that your Spirit would just come to them in such a real and personal way today that they would say yes to Jesus, and that they would find eternal life in the eternal life giver today. And Father, we just ask you, Lord, to walk with us in this service. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Amen.
As we continue studying the book of Galatians, we found last week that we come to faith and trust in Jesus Christ and we become a child of God. But not only do we become a child of God in position, but we are given the nature of a child of God. So, in other words, if you and I are a child of God, not only should we be able to go to heaven, but you and I should be able to live a life as a child of God, wanting to desire to do the will of the Father while we're here on earth. We should want to please our Heavenly Father. But Paul moves on from that thought, and he wants to demonstrate the weakness of following the law. Now, these people, when we think of the term, you hear people use the term falling from grace. Now, when you think of falling from grace, when you hear people talk about that, they're talking about losing your salvation. That's not what the Bible term for falling from grace means. It is what the Galatians are guilty of here, that they have had faith and trust in Jesus Christ, they've experienced the grace of God, and now they're going to go back and try to make themselves right through living the law. They have left grace and came to the law. And that's not what God said to do. God has taught us and shown us that we're to live in His will and His desires, and it's not about the law, it's about a relationship and faith and trust in Jesus Christ every day that we live. And friends, we know a lot about law in our churches, don't we?
Yeah.
Huh?
Right.
What would we think about when we think about law in our churches? We think about tradition. We think about this is how we've always done it, and that's how we're going to do it, and we're not going to do it any different. I've seen a lot of law as I travel from churches to different churches, not just in revivals, not just before I came here, but as I've been around and seen other churches, I know that there are a lot of laws, a lot of rules that exist in our churches, and that we're going to do it that way because that's how it's going to be done. Now, I want to give you a rather extreme example of understanding that we sometimes experience law in our churches. I have a friend who he moved to Georgia to pastor a church. And some people got saved, and revival broke out in the church. And friends, revival got so alive in that church that people were leaving the church, they were going home, and they were coming back, and they were dumping sackfuls of alcohol and drugs and pornography on the altar and saying, "I quit that mess. I'm going with Jesus. I love Him. I want to be with Him." They were turning their lives over to Christ completely. They were surrendering to things that stood between them and Christ. Now, here's law in our churches. So a guy comes came up to him and he said, we don't do things like that in our church. We don't allow people to come and do things like that in our church. I don't know what y'all did in Tennessee, but we don't do that down here in Georgia. And my pastor friend replied, we do now. We do now. Listen, when the Spirit of God gets a hold of the people of God, it don't matter what your traditions are. You just go with God. You just do what God's telling you to do. You answer to God. See, you and I, we need to understand that people sometimes when they get right, they decide to clean house. Huh? When they get right with God, they want to go home and they want to clean house. They want to make sure that they are removing from their lives the things that would keep them from Christ. Now, I want you to look at me at what the Word tells us. How weak the law is. How strong our faith and trust in Jesus Christ is. But look at verses 8 and 9. Now, Paul asks the question. How be it then when you knew not God, you did service unto them which by nature know God, but now after that you know God, or rather are known to God, how turn you again to the weak and beggarly elements wherein you desire again to be in bondage? Now, I want you to think about this for a moment. What were you in bondage to before you got saved? Now just think on that for a minute, okay? Think on the fact that at some point in your life, you were in bondage to something. There was something in your life that separated you from God. Now, for the Galatians, they were mainly Gentiles. They were primarily, their biggest problem, if we look at their society that they were living in, the biggest problem that the Galatians had prior to coming to Christ was that they were idolaters. They were idolaters. They worshipped other gods with a little cheek. They built magnificent temples, and they built places of worship, and they built monuments and statues, and they went about their whole life trying to figure out how to please these gods who really weren't gods. I mean, they things would go wrong in their life, and they would go, uh-oh, we've made the gods mad. We've got to figure out. Now, they even got to the point, they got so backwards in understanding that the difference in God and gods that they even offered their children as sacrifices. He said, oh, Brother Jeffrey, we don't know nothing about that. Hello, we wore babies all year long in this country.
Yeah.
We ain't sacrificing the gods, but we're sacrificing our children. Hello?
All right, man.
You think we're not that backward? Yes, we are. Now, let me back up. They were idolaters. So what were you in bondage to? Now, I asked you that. What were you in bondage to? Well, you might say, well, I was a drunk, Brother Jeff. Or someone else might say, well, I was sexually immoral. Or maybe someone says, well, I lived for myself. I sought to please myself, and I was my God. I did whatever made me feel good, and that's what I did. And so if you look at my life, I was more living for the moment, and I broke the law and was deemed a sinner in all kinds of ways. That'd be how I was. I mean, I can't go back and just say, oh, well, this was my one big problem. I mean, I can tell you some things that were my problem, but I can tell you that there were multiple things that were in my life that obviously were separating me from God. But it don't matter if it was one thing or a multitude of things, one ounce of one sin on your count separates you from God. That's what the Bible said.
Right.
You know, but even then we got so religious in our country and in our churches here that we think that we some sins are acceptable, and so we don't see the problem with a little bit of sin. Friends, listen, Paul is saying, look, you can go over here, you can have faith and trust in Jesus Christ and a relationship with Him, or you can say, I'm going to live by the law, and you're going to be a lawbreaker because you cannot keep the law. See, one day, if you're really saved, there was a day when you finally came to the realization that you needed Jesus Christ, your Lord. So you realized that there was sin in your life, that it separated you from God, and without Christ, you were going to die and perish in a place called hell. Are y'all buckled up out there? Good Lord, if y'all put there with that spirit to Bethel Hill tonight, I believe I'll just pull my hair out. Huh? Come on. Come on now. This is ridiculous. Did y'all lose your best friend this week? I did, and his name
But listen, you know, at some point, we realized our need for Christ. And we found mercy and grace from our Lord Jesus Christ. Now, let me ask you something. When you found the mercy and grace of the Lord Jesus Christ, when you realized that you're a sinner and you realized that Jesus loved you and He was reaching out to you and saying, I want you. I want to have a relationship with you. I desire you. Now, did that not feel great when you realized that God loved you and He wanted you in spite of your sin? Well, I still remember what it's like. I thought I could fly. I did. The night I got saved, I thought I could fly. I've told y'all this before. I'm glad I didn't try, but I did. I thought I could fly. I mean, I was just on cloud nine that God had not left me the way I was, but rather He came and He got a hold of me and He saved me from my sin. It felt good. Way better if you remember that. Remember how you felt. Don't ever forget. But let me tell you something else worse than that, not to forget. Don't ever forget what it was like to be lost. Don't ever forget what it was like to know you was a lawbreaker. Then you won't have to worry about trying to keep the law because you realize I didn't measure up to begin with. It was the grace and mercy of Jesus that brought me to God.
Amen.
See, the Bible, it describes being in sin like being in prison. Now think about that for a minute. How old were you when you got saved? How old were you when you got saved? Some people say, well, I was a little child. Okay. Some people like me, they say, well, I was 17 years old, or maybe you're 18 years old. Or maybe you're sitting here and you say, well, no, you know, Brother Jeff, I was on up in years. You know, I was in my 30s, my 40s. I was older than that when I got saved. Let me tell you something. The Bible says and describes that being in sin is like being in prison. And so the Bible says in John 8:36, if the Son therefore shall make you free, you shall be free indeed. Now, why is that important? Because the day you got saved, it was like the prison gate opened up, and you, if you're a man or woman, wherever you are, you walked out a free man or a free woman. Listen, I was 17 years old, and the night I got saved, it was like the jail door swung open, and I walked out free, free, free. Released from all the guilt, released from all the shame that had captured my heart and that had kept me apart from God. He was suddenly gone, friends.
Yeah.
I'll bless myself. Certainly you're free, the Bible says. Certainly you're changing God. Now, how many of y'all love the hymn Amazing Grace?
Hey.
I love the hymn Amazing Grace. But you know what I love even more? I love that they redid the hymn Amazing Grace. I love that they redid it. Not that they changed anything else, but that they added something to it. When they started singing, my chains are gone.
Man.
I've been set free. I remember what it was like when my chains fell off. I can remember, listen folks, I can literally, and this is why I preach so hard and why I preach so fervently about people getting saved, because I'm afraid there's many in our churches who don't know what it's like to really be set free. I mean, I remember sitting in the mirror in bondage to my sin, and I remember falling at the altar in that old church in downtown Tennessee with my father-in-law and praying to God that God would take me and that He would cleanse my sin. And I remember being free. I can remember it just like it was yesterday. My chains are gone. I've been set free. Paul's wanting us to know. He said, what are you thinking going back under that which could not save you, that which could not set you free, that which demanded your death, that which put you in those chains? Why would you ever go back and try to serve that? But people do it. It's happening in churches. It happens in our churches. It happens in other denominations. Listen, these people, they were able to do service to their gods. They were able to do service to their gods and please these gods who had no feelings. Matter of fact, I love how Paul describes it. And he's telling the Corinthians about it at one point. He says, those dumb idols.
Yeah.
Now, he didn't mean stupid. You know what he meant? He meant they can't speak.
Right.
They have no feeling.
Man.
They can't do anything for you. And yet they worship it. And yet they gave to it. Listen, hey, they tithe better than them idols. And some people tithe to Jesus. Hello?
Right.
No, they gave to those idols. They gave. They sacrificed. They took it. They even sacrificed their children. Listen, friends, we need to understand something. These people were in the same shape that many people are in today.
Yep.
They don't understand a relationship. person. Listen, I'm not going to lie to you. I'm in love with Jesus.
Yeah.
I'm in love with Jesus because He died for me. He gave everything for me. He has my best interest at heart all the way to the cross of Calvary. He has my best interest at heart now that He's risen and stands at the right hand of the Father, making intercession for those who come to Him. Listen, I want to please God. But there are many who don't even make an attempt in their life to please God because they're too busy trying to keep the rules. The rules which cannot help them. Look at verse 10. It says, you observe days and months and times and years. Now, they had gone back into the law so much that they were keeping Sabbaths. Okay? They were keeping Sabbaths. They were observing the change in the moons. That's what it's talking about. When it says there that they observed months, that was the changing of the moons. When it talks about that they were observing the times, that was the feast. And then when they talk about the years, there was Sabbath years. Every so many years, the Sabbath required that certain things had to take place on a yearly basis, not just on a daily or on a weekly basis. So they were in the law deep. But you know what? We got people who are law keepers today. How do you know that, Brother Jed? Because they believe when you break the law. Now, listen to this. When you break the law, and I'm talking about God's law, to a certain point, it's okay. But when you cross over and reach a certain degree, then now you have crossed the line, and now you are too bad for your salvation. You have lost your salvation. When you have lawkeepers, listen to me, hear me. Churches that teach law keeping also teach that there is no eternal security.
Right.
Why? Because it is no longer based on Christ. It is based on something I can do. And if I can do it, I'll mess it up, my friends.
Amen. Amen.
But you know what? I needed a Savior and I needed salvation because I was a law breaker.
Amen.
I don't need someone to tell me that I'm not good enough to go to heaven because I realized because of the law, I was not able to save myself. I'm a lawbreaker. But the law keepers tell you, well, if you're going to do this and you do that, then you'll lose your salvation. There's no eternal security. Well, what if there's no eternal security, then why did God allow the words to be penned in Hebrews chapter 10, verse 14? This is just one verse among many, but Hebrews chapter 10, verse 14 says, for by one offering He hath perfected forever them that are sanctified.
Yeah, right.
Had a friend who used to say, get sanctified or get french fried. Huh?
Right.
Your choice. You can get saved, you can get sanctified, you can get set apart, or you can stay the way you are and you will be apart from God and one day you'll perish in a place called hell. But for those who are saved, He hath perfected forever. Not He hath perfected until they sin again. Not He hath perfected until they break the law again. He hath perfected forever them that are sanctified. Salvation is not till you and I mess up. It is a divine act. Did you hear that? Salvation is a divine act.
Right.
Salvation is not a human act.
Right.
Salvation is a divine act on the part of God, whereby God declares you and I not guilty. And it happens one time in the believer's life, and it never occurs again, because God says, not guilty.
Amen.
That's why you walk out of prison free.
Right.
Because He said you wasn't guilty. They don't keep people who are not guilty in jail. Right? Oh, we mess up this society to do sometimes, but God would not keep someone in prison who was not guilty. That's why you're able to go free. See, we have brothers and sisters in Christ. I'll take this a little bit further. They still observe the Sabbath day. Now listen, I have no problem. Sunday is not the Sabbath. You hear me? It's not the Sabbath. But I have no problem with our brothers and sisters who serve God on the Sabbath, on Saturday. So, Brother Jeff, so you're saying that Saturday is the Sabbath? Absolutely. There's nowhere in the Bible where it was ever revoked, okay? Well, wait a minute. Wait a minute, Brother Jeff. Then we're messing up. That's law. Why we worship on Sunday? Because the Bible says on the first day of the week they went to the tomb and they looked for my Savior and He was not there because He was alive and arose from the dead. That's why I worship on Sunday. Now, wait a minute. But they're worshiping on Saturday. You know what? We ought to worship God every day.
Amen.
Hello? If you're just coming here on Sunday morning and thinking you're getting your worshiping over for the week and you're going back to your week, you are sadly mistaken. You and I ought to worship God every day of our life instead of let everything that hath breath praise the Lord.
Amen.
Praise you the Lord. That's a good sermon for today since y'all just stuck up this morning. worship on Saturday. You say, well, worshiping on Sunday will put you in hell. Well, James chapter 2, verse 10, the Bible says, for whosoever shall keep the whole law and yet offend in one point, he's guilty of all. Now, you can't tell me that some of our brothers and sisters who worship on Saturday don't lie sometimes. Ain't stole at some point. Ain't done something that God's not pleased with. Worship their money more than they worship God. Listen, I'm not trying to split hairs this morning. I just want you to understand that the law was our undoing and our condemnation. He was not there to help us. He was to point us to the fact that we were guilty in need of Christ. It was weak, but faith in Christ was strong enough to save us because Jesus loved us enough. He died for us. Verses 11 and 12, look at this. Look at this. Now, this is a nice way of saying what Paul said. He says, I'm afraid of you. Now, that didn't make him scared. No, what he was saying was, he's saying, I hope I've not spent all my time there for no reason. He says, I'm afraid of you, lest I have bestowed upon you labor in vain. In other words, I spent all this time with you, and nothing changed. Brethren, I beseech you, be as I am, for I am as you are. You have not injured me at all. Paul's saying, come on now. I don't want to have wasted my time ministering there. I mean, I went about and told people your salvation. I went and told people how great you all have done and how loving you were towards me. Now, don't make me have to go back and tell them, well, somebody come in and start teaching them some bogus theology and they bought into it and they started living it. Man, they just all messed up. Listen, he wanted them to know that they need to return to living by faith. And he spends, as his final plea, it's maybe the next chapter and a half here, he spends this time making a final plea saying, return to living by faith because it's the only way to live. Now, he gives it, he offers himself as that, he says, be as I am. And he says, the reason you can be like I am is because I'm just like you are. Now, what was Paul saying? Paul's saying, we're all the same. When it comes down to it, we've all done it wrong. We're all guilty before God. Yeah. And if it were not for faith and trust in Jesus Christ, if it were not for the mercy, grace, and love of the Lord Jesus Christ, then none of us would be good enough to get there. So Paul's saying, we're all the same anyways. So why don't you just look at me and see my example of walking by faith? See, Paul told him, he said, I'm the chief among sinners. He said, if anybody's messed up, it's me. So what you all are doing in Galatia is no worse than anything I've ever done. So I left all that. I left the law, and I'm running the race of faith. Why don't you join me? Why don't you follow in my footsteps? That's why the Apostle Paul could say this. He said in Philippians chapter 3, verse 14, I press toward the mark of the prize of the high calling of God in Christ Jesus. He was saying, you know what? I've tried everything else. And he said, give me Jesus. Amen. I've tried it all. Give me Jesus and I'm going forward. Give me Jesus and I'll show you how my faith works. Give me Jesus. But now he calls attention to how their faith in Christ had led them to develop the character of Christ in their life. Now, how do I know that? Because he talks about how they've not injured him. They've not hurt him in any way. But rather, he speaks about in the next three verses here, verses 13, 14, and 15, he's been speaking about how great a blessing they were. Now, what did he say about them? He said in verse 13, you know how through infirmity of the flesh I preached the gospel to you at the first, and my temptation was in my flesh you despised not nor rejected, but receive me as an angel of God. Now, listen to what he said. Even as Christ Jesus. You received me like Christ. Where is then the blessedness you spake of? For I bear you record that if it had been possible, you would have plucked out your own eyes and had given them to me. Now, y'all tell me something scripture that I never understood before. How many people have always wondered what Paul's thorn in the flesh was? I did too. You realize what was wrong with him? He had some kind of eye disease. And you say, that's crazy, Brother Jeff. You're saying that from that right there, that you get that? Well, he says that it was an infirmity of the flesh. In other words, there was some weakness in the flesh. And then he says that you love me so much, you wanted to bless me so much that you plucked your eyes out of me. I'm just saying. Paul says, even though he had this problem and it was in his fleshly body, he said, you received me. Now, according to what
some popular theologists what they believe, this disease that Paul had made his eyes run with pus. And so constantly his eyes were getting all jumped up and he couldn't see very well at times. He would have been a bad looking person because of that. But they didn't look at his fleshly appearance. They looked and heard on what he was saying from the heart. See, even though he was struggling with this trial in his life, they were listening to what God had to say through him. And Paul's saying, you all were so close to God at that point that you would have given your eyes to help me out so that I wouldn't have had to deal with that so I could preach the gospel. You are a people changed by God. Now, why is that important? Because we talked about last week that those who have faith and trust in Jesus Christ become a child of God. And if you become a child of God, friends, then you're going to take on the character of Christ. And Christ's character, he went to those who were suffering physically. He loved them and he tried to help those who were hurting, and he did help many who were hurting. Christ never turned them away. People that the world rejected, Christ received.
Right.
People that the world said, they're second best, they're no good, they're nothing. He said, I want you. Come to me. He said, come to me. He said, share in my life and share and let me share my life with you. And so finally he makes the ultimate sacrifice, dying perfect man for the sins of the world. He loved them so much and loved us so much that he even died for them. And they were willing to make a sacrifice in their life. Maybe it wasn't death, but it was a huge sacrifice for Paul that they could help him. Now, I've said this to you before, but this is so important. The mark of the unchanged heart is the unchanged life.
Right.
The mark of the unchanged heart is the unchanged life. If the relationship you claim to have with Christ has not made you more compassionate, if the relationship you claim to have with Christ has not made you want to reach out to those who are hurting, maybe they're hurting physically, maybe they're hurting spiritually, if not knowing Christ has not, given you a heart that looks beyond self and is willing to sacrifice, I'm sorry, but you don't know my Jesus.
Amen.
Because my Jesus gave it all. And if my Jesus lives in your heart, then my Jesus will have changed your heart to the place where you love other people, where you want to reach out to other people, where you sacrifice self over, you sacrifice yourself in order to help others. You are willing to give up what you want in favor of helping someone else. Now listen, you can reject that message this morning. And you can deny where you're really at in your life. But you're lying to yourself. You're not lying to nobody. Well, you're lying to God, but you're not lying to anybody else in this room, but you're lying to yourself. If your heart's not more compassionate, if you're not more wanting to reach out to other people, if you don't have a genuine care and concern for others, if you're not willing to sacrifice self, if you're still selfish and claim to be saved, then you're lying to yourself. Why is it that when truth convicts us and it hits us, we won't kill the messenger? See, the same thing happened here. You say, oh, what do you mean, Brother Jeff? Look at verse 16. Am I therefore become your enemy because I tell you the truth?
Amen.
J. Vernon McGee said this. He said he always wanted on his pulpit, on the preacher side here, sir, we would see Jesus. To remind him every time he got up to preach, to show the people Jesus, to give them a picture of Jesus. But he said that he always went to the pulpit and on this side of the pulpit said, am I therefore become your enemy because I tell you the truth? See, when people tell you the truth, sometimes it makes you mad. Listen, I found that out early in my ministry. There's some men in this room can testify to that. That I found it out early in my ministry, even before I ever got to this church. That I found out that people don't always love the truth. And because they didn't always love the truth, guess what? They didn't love me. See, God has given me a ministry, and He has given every God-called minister a ministry of truth. Did you notice what I said? Every God-called minister. The ministry of truth. If they ain't telling the truth, they ain't calling God.
Amen.
If they're lying through their teeth, when they stand behind God's sacred desk, they ain't calling God. Because God's men tell the truth from the pulpit. See, it was so
bad. I had developed enemies in the ministry before I got to this church. It was so bad, I almost didn't get to preach in this church. Now, that wasn't anybody's fault here at this church, but it was people's fault who had lied about what was going on. I had preached the truth, and I had made people mad, and they were calling me a troublemaker. Hello? A troublemaker. I had the name of a troublemaker for preaching the truth. I've been in two churches, now I don't recall their names, but I've been in two churches, and because I stood on the Word of God, they labeled me as trouble. I didn't fit into what they wanted to say and what they wanted to do. And so instead of acknowledging God's Word and lining up with God's Word, they chose to take it out on me. Now, I'll say something. Brother Danny even mentioned this morning while he was teaching. But if you don't like what I have to say, take it up with God. He wrote the book. I just call it the way the Bible says it. You know why we get mad? When people tell us the truth, though, there's two reasons. Two reasons we get mad.
Well,
nobody likes to hear that they're wrong. Nobody likes to hear that they're wrong. It don't matter if it's about church or anything else. Nobody likes to be told they're wrong. Just ask my wife. I don't like to be told I'm wrong. I like to be right. I like to be right. I like for it to be the way I said it was. Sometimes I say it thinking I'm telling it right. She says, no, 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 honey, that's not it. Because I want to be right. All you boneheaded men, you know it's the truth too. You do the same thing. But listen, when it comes to church, there's a second reason why we get upset when someone tells us the truth. And Jesus highlighted this in John chapter 8, verse 47, when he said, "He that is of God heareth God's words. Ye therefore hear them not, because you're not of God." People get mad when we tell the truth because it challenges whether they really belong to God or not.
Amen.
Because if you belong to God, listen, when God's Word goes out, you enjoy, you love the fact that God allows you to encounter Him. You're thankful for the fact that you're able to line your life up with what God has asked you to do. Now, if you don't belong to God, you know what you do?
Preacher. That preacher said all that stuff. I don't believe what he says.
Well, you believe the Bible? Hello? Paul said, "Am I your enemy now? Are you going to be mad? Are you going to sit soaked and sour and sulk up because I told you the truth? Are you going to do something about it? Or are you going to respond to the truth?" Verse 17 and 18. Now remember, there were people who had come in and were teaching things differently than what Paul had taught. They were teaching them that they also, it was faith plus works. But Paul had taught them faith plus nothing to be saved. Listen to this. "They zealously affect you, but not well. Yea, they would exclude you that you might affect them. But it is good to be zealously affected always in a good thing, and not only when I am present with you." Now, what's Paul saying there? Paul says, it's okay for someone to come in there and light a fire among you if they're trying to push you towards something that's good. But he said, guess what? These guys that showed up and started teaching you these things, he said, it wasn't about bringing you towards something good. It was for their own benefit.
Yeah.
They were leading these people away from the truth. They were leading these people to a place where they did not need to go. And they were doing it because they wanted to be able to say, "Oh, Paul, he couldn't convert them, wicked Galatians. But we did. We taught them that they had to trust Jesus Christ, and then they'd keep that law, and they'd be right with God if they could keep that law to the letter of the law now." And that's what would happen. Paul says, guess what? They led you to something that cannot help you. They led you to false teaching, which, if you follow it, will lead you down a path you don't want to go. See, there's a lot of false teaching going on today. And it's getting a lot of followers.
Yeah.
Because false teaching looks good on the outside. But on the inside, it leads you down a path you don't want to travel. What do you mean, Brother Jim? Well, there's this teaching out there that God just loves you. He just wants to bless you. He just wants the very best thing for your life. And you're to have your best life now. Friends, if this is my best life, what is it?
Right.
My best life is not on this earth.
That's
my best life is coming. It is when this earth fades and when I stand before my Savior face to face. But listen, it's gathered a big folly because it sounds good that God loves everybody and God just wants to bless everybody and God just wants to do all these good things for people. That's not my God. God does love people. God does want to bless people. But that's half truth, and that's a lie.
Yeah.
Anything that's not the whole truth and nothing but the truth is a lie. And listen, one day when we stand before God, we'll have to answer for what we did with the truth that He revealed to us. The Bible says that the truth will make you free. Heads are bowed and eyes are closed all across the world.